Whacking is a way of life at St. George's, and one that ex-music and dormitory master Dave Barrett came to detest. For example, the long late-night punishment queues outside the headmaster's study.
Now, often I was told by the boys afterwards that they'd actually been beaten, pants down, punished in their pyjamas, or whatever they happened to be wearing at the time. I mean, if they happened to be in the shower, then they'd go as they were to the headmaster's study. At Christmas, there were house parties, and from what the boys said, there were games with forfeits, and the forfeits included a 9-year-old boy drinking down a glass of sherry in one go, an 11-year-old boy taking off his clothes and acting the role of Tarzan on top of a table, and another boy, again totally naked, running round the school. No other members of staff were ever present apart from the headmaster at these functions.
Nigel Kenton Barnes went to one, though.
At Christmas, you used to have house parties. It's supposed to be to cheer people up because it's near Christmas, and there used to be some odd games going on. Mrs. Slade used to dish out forfeits. This game, if you can't answer the questions, you get a forfeit. Some people were made to sort of swap clothes or take all their clothes off. One time he did this boy operation. He laid him on the table and sort of digging into and sort of like that, and the boy started to cry because of it. Didn't like it, he hurt him, I think.
Dave Barrett heard lots of stories like that one, and unfortunately they weren't the half of it.
Whilst checking the dormitories after lights out, I frequently noticed boys missing from their beds, and on inquiring as to their whereabouts, I was told by other boys that they were in such and such a person's room. Nearly always, I think it was the housemaster's room. There was never what seemed to be a good reason for being in there. One particular night, a 10-year-old boy was missing for about the fourth night in succession from his bed, whereupon I went straight up to the housemaster's room, banged on the door, and demanded that the boy be returned to the dormitory, which didn't happen. So I went to the headmaster, complained to the headmaster about it, and I said, what about the other boys that were always missing from the dormitory? He refused to comment about those, and on pressing my point, he flew into a rage and more or less ordered me off the premises. This was 11:30 at night. There are no buses from Great Finborough, it's right in the middle of the country, and my flat was in Colchester, and I had to pay something like £30 to get a taxi home at that time of night.
The housemaster, Mr. Singer, later fled the country, so while Mr. Barrett was summarily fired, Mr. Singer was allowed to leave relatively quietly. Once again, as staff and pupils have found, it doesn't do to complain at St. George's.
Well, it's a hard school, really. You have to be a sort of a creep to get on with Mr. Slade. You have to do everything perfectly to get on with him. And if you're a little bit bad, you've had it. We had a lot of teachers, either they got sacked because Mr. Slade didn't agree with them, or they left because they didn't like the system. We had about 4 different maths teachers once, sort of swapping and swapping. We didn't know what we were doing, really. Well, I didn't really get a good education. I don't know whether it was his fault, the things he'd done like Reigns of Terrors, or my fault, but I only got 6 CSEs and 1 grade D O level. Not very good education, really. Find it hard to get a job at the moment.
Teachers we've talked to have often raised the subject of inadequate equipment and inadequate backup. Monica Schweitzer-Kaschab taught German, the 4th teacher in a year to attempt so to do.
When I arrived, I was just sort of given a timetable and told to get on with it. I had absolutely nothing to go by. I didn't know how far the children had got in their learning of German. I didn't have any textbooks. I had absolutely no record, no mark books, nothing. What really horrified me was that once I started work there, the children would come time and time again and complain about discontinuity, and that was to blame, that their German was so bad. And it was particularly frustrating because everything was linked up to the whoever person had been taking them. So this one particular teacher where this homosexual scandal was attached to, that was very, very difficult because the children just would not use the books. They would want new exercise books, new vocabulary books. And their standard of German was absolutely appalling.
Similar stories are told about other subjects like French and science. St. George's prospectus gives the impression that good exam results were achieved long before any of its pupils ever sat a public examination. But success where achieved, say teachers, is often despite the school rather than because of it. Some teachers fear it's not primarily an educational establishment at all. It's actually a limited company, Anglemoss Limited, with Derek Slade as chairman of the board. Dave Barrett certainly doubts the company's motives. So does Nick Cottam, who resigned from St George's last week in order to take part in this programme.
I think there was a feeling that St George's is very much a private enterprise. Of course, there's no board of governors. Derek Slade took charge completely himself from the top as regards policy and saying exactly what he wanted to do. Now, the only way you could have possibly complained was perhaps to an outside union. No one, in fact, belonged to a union. Again, I think it was this attitude that it was quite pointless because unions really wouldn't have bothered themselves with an institution like this. And so there was a feeling you shrugged your shoulders if you weren't happy and you attempted to find the best possible alternative. People who perhaps didn't have family commitments were able to leave much more quickly. Other people were hustled out because of their attitudes to the school.
Other members of staff had complained, and some of them had been given the sack on the spot. Others had been given warning letters saying that they would be sacked. As far as I was concerned, I wanted to, as far as possible, stay on the right side of the authorities, because obviously the headmaster being the company chairman and the chairman of the board of directors, and also the person that I would have to complain to, it was not easy to complain. There was no deputy head at the time, although later there was a deputy head who was, of course, the headmaster's brother, who, again, it was rather difficult to complain to. But I knew, as most of the staff did, that jobs were hard to come by.
So teachers accepted employment and stayed on, despite a contract described to us by the National Union of Teachers as the most extreme they'd ever seen, despite the long hours, the low pay and the regular bouts of misery. The whole thing's a crying shame, says Dave Barrett.
Really, there's the basis for an extremely good school there. But I just think that the whole system is mismanaged, the boys are obviously abused, and the tremendous potential which there is at the school is just not being realised. I think all in all, with the official fights, the intensity and frequency of the beatings and over-enforcement of the disciplinary system as a whole, the rather strange games which were invented on the premises, and peculiar traditions which the headmaster was seemingly trying to establish. Taking all this into consideration, it's rather like an episode from Tom Brown's school days.
And a very bad episode at that. The Ministry of Defence declined to comment and referred us to the Department of Education and Science, and they told us,
"We've heard rumours and allegations concerning St George's, and Her Majesty's Inspectors of Schools have visited the place more than once. The Suffolk Police have also been involved, but we've had no formal complaint in writing."
Difficult to credit that, but until one arrives, they say, they can't take any action. Mr. Slade professed amazement at the allegations made against him and his school, and before giving an interview, wanted them spelt out in writing. This we did by telegram. But while we were on our way to see him, he had a letter delivered to our office which concluded that it wasn't in the public interest for this program to be broadcast. So our reception, which included a rather hefty staff member, came as something of a surprise.
Do you know where he is?
Yes, well, he should be at home. Are you from the BBC?
That's right, yes. Yes. We said we'd drop by.
He has passed a message on, actually, to say that he's not going to take part in an interview at all because he's been given legal advice not to.
We'd still like to have a word with him anyway.
Well, I think he's in London or on his
way
to London.
Yes, he's
or something,
on his way to London at the moment.
Hang on, you said he was at home a minute ago.
Can I help you?
Yes, we came to see Mr. Slade.
He's not here, he's in London.
Oh, well, we were told a minute ago he was at home.
No, sorry, he's in London.
I see. Where can he be contacted in London?
He can't. Right.
Why can't he?
Because he can't. There's no why about it. He simply can't be contacted.
Right. When will he be available then?
Don't know. I really don't know.
Who are you?
I'm a member of staff.
Mm-hmm. And your name is?
Oh, don't worry about that.
Well, come on, you've got nothing
to
hide. What's what's your name?
The fact is, the headmaster's not here. He's legally bound now not to say anything. You're on private property. Would you please leave?
Can I have your name before I do that?
No, I'll give you mine now. I've got no reason to give you my name either. Mm.
Are you happy with the way this school's run?
Yes, very.
Are you?
Yeah. Mm. It's private property.
Of course it's private property.
We're quite within our rights to throw you off. We're not going to throw you off. We're going to get nasty about it. We'd like to...
Well, that's one of the reasons we came, you see, because a lot of people have said that nasty things do happen here.
Well, that sounds a bit ridiculous, doesn't it? You know, the way you're going, it's absolutely ludicrous.
Would you give us any assistance whatsoever?
No.
Why not?
Because I've been told not to. It's as simple as that.
Mr. Slade later had his lawyer send us a letter retracting the first one and threatening legal action. He even tried to involve his MP. He's been unavailable ever since. so he won't be giving us his views on education, or even contesting those of David Freeman, author of the soon-to-be-published Good Schools Guide to Independent Schools.
I was alerted to this school by an official in the Ministry of Defence, who had had worries about it for some years. I went to see it for myself. I formed the impression that the regime of the school was extremely repressive. The standard of teaching gave me severe misgivings. There appeared to be inadequate equipment, inadequate experience among the staff. And it worries me very much that the Department of Defence is prepared to spend large sums in maintaining this school. We're talking of about £500,000 a year.
So if they wanted to, with this amount of pull, as it were, the service authorities could insist on changes?
Oh, yes, they could. If the service allowance were withheld, the school would be unable to continue.
What do you think of Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Schools? How much can be hidden from them? After all, this sort of thing seems to have been going on for a number of years now.
Well, of course, the inspection of independent schools is no longer obligatory. But in any case where an inspection does take place, it's always possible for a school, with warning, to put on a plausible show. And I dare say that might have happened at some time in this case.
You wouldn't like any kind of outside supervision?
I don't think it's necessary. I think that the independent schools are quite capable of ensuring that they run properly.
But in this case, that hasn't happened.
No, it hasn't happened in this case, and I do regard this case as exceptional. I haven't come across another school like it this century. It's an unfettered autocracy, a tyranny.
David Freeman.
I think it's very hard to realise the full extent of certainly sexual behaviour of this kind, because paedophiles are extremely good at covering up their tracks, and clearly Derek Slade was engaged in some very devious behaviour.
The road is long. Hey there.